Good morning and welcome to this service on the first Sunday in the month of June. My name is Norm Hrofker and I'm proud to be the minister of this congregation, the Universalist Unitarian Church of Halifax, established in 1837. Jessica Friesen is our music director, Marie-Claude Leroux, our director of religious exploration, and John Piccolo is our volunteer technician. During the service today, the chat function will be available, and I invite you to say hello to anyone that you don't recognize. Let's extend our hospitality in the best way that we can. If you're new or returning after a long absence, you may want to leave your contact information in the chat section. And if you're not already receiving notification from the church and you'd like to receive updates on our activities and our services, please send an email to minister@uuch.ca. Before the service begins, I have just a few announcements. The order of service for today was sent out over UU Info on Friday, and it contains more detail on the following. Every Thursday evening at 7 p.m., we're hosting an online gathering to allow us to break out of our isolation. There's information there on how to connect with that online Zoom call. If you would like to do so, we'd be happy to have more people participating. Appropriate to the topic today, the Dismantling Racism Study Group of the CUC has extended their deadline for the survey, but the survey closes for the last time today. So again, have a look at the order of services information there, or go to the CUC website and look for more information. They're looking for as much feedback as they can get on this very important study. Now, each week in the service, we pause to acknowledge that we're on unceded Mi'kmaq territory. The original settlers of Turtle Island built relationships with the Indigenous peoples because they needed those relationships to survive in an unforgiving landscape. But later, they became too busy to sustain those relationships. They were too busy cutting forests and damming rivers and digging for gold, harvesting fish, and making money, and organizing churches. Seen this way, not too much has changed. Are we all too busy to heal a relationship? This congregation has undertaken a number of initiatives to help us to learn the hard truths of our history, and we're currently planning our way forward for the fall. If you'd like to be part of healing our relationships with our Indigenous neighbors, please contact me. I'm busy, but not too busy for this work. I need a community around me to remind me of what is important, and I think you do too. Jessica is preparing a prelude for us, and you may hear the theme of bridges in our service today. Jessica selected a beautifully appropriate piece for our prelude.
Good morning, everyone. I have chosen Bridge Over Troubled Waters, written and composed by Paul Simon. So sit back, enjoy, sing along if you know it, and here we go. When you're weary, feeling small, when tears are in
Thank you.
And now as we cross the threshold and enter the sacred part of our service, I invite Kyla Saunier to read the chalice lighting words for us. Kyla?
Hi, I'm Kyla Saunier, and I will read the chalice lighting words. We light this chalice today in honor of the Unitarian Universalist first principle, to affirm and promote the inherent worth and dignity of every person. We recognize that these are not just words to be spoken. Instead, they call us out of our comfort into an ever-deepening commitment, a commitment we make to the rights of all, whose inherent worth and dignity are denied, diminished, or destroyed by systems of oppression. And they call us into the practice of looking into our own hearts with courage and honesty. Back to you, Norm.
Thank you, Kyla. And I'll once again light the chalice here in our sanctuary, keeping the light alive until we can return here in person. Marie-Claude has prepared a story for all of us this morning, and there's a special video message as well. Marie-Claude?
Good morning, everyone. Today, I'll be reading the story Wings by Christopher Myers. This is the story of a boy's resilient spirit that inspires one girl to speak up for him. Look at that strange boy. Everyone from the neighborhood is pointing fingers and watching the sky. How is he doing that? They stretch their necks, shake their heads. Icarus Jackson, a new boy on my block, is flying above the rooftops. He is swooping and diving, looping past people's windows and over the crowd. I don't think he's strange. Icarus Jackson, the flyboy, came to my school last Thursday. His long, strong, proud wings followed wherever he went. The whole school was staring eyes and wagging tongues. They whispered about his wings and his hair and his shoes, like they whisper about how quiet I am. Our teacher complained that the other kids couldn't help but gawk and stare. He said that Icarus's wings blocked that blackboard and made it hard for the students to pay attention. The teacher told Icarus to leave class until he could figure out what to do with his wings. He left the room quietly, dragging his feathers behind him. One boy snickered. At recess, the snicker grew into a giggle and spread across the playground. Soon, all the kids were laughing at Icarus Jackson's useless wings. I thought that if he flew just once, everyone would stop laughing. Icarus looked up, flapped his wings a couple of times, and then jumped into the air. He swept through the schoolyard like a slow motion instant replay. But the other kids were not impressed. One girl grabbed the basketball, a boy stuffed the handball in his pocket, and somebody nagged, "Nobody likes a show off." Their words sent Icarus drifting into the sky, away from the glaring eyes and the pointing fingers. I waited for them to point back at me as I watched Icarus float further and further away. Walking home from school, I knew how he felt, how lonely he must be. Maybe I should have said something to those mean kids. I ran through the streets with my eyes to the sky, searching the clouds for Icarus. He struggled to stay in the air. His wings drooped and his head hung low. He landed heavily on the edge of a building and sat with the pigeons. Pigeons don't make fun of people. A policeman passing by blew his whistle. You with the wings, come down from there. Stay yourself on the ground. You'll get in trouble. You'll get hurt. It seemed to me Icarus was already in trouble and hurt. Could the policeman put him in jail for flying? For being too different? When the neighborhood kids saw the policeman yelling at him, they exploded with laughter. Icarus dropped to the ground. Stop, I cried. Leave him alone. And they did. I called to Icarus and he sailed closer to me. I told him what someone should have long ago. Your flying is beautiful. For the first time, I saw Icarus smile. At that moment, I forgot about the kids who had laughed at him and me. I was just glad the Icarus had found his wings again. Look at that amazing boy, I called to all the people on the street as I pointed to my nose swirling through the sky. Speaking up for Icarus lifted everyone up. We're all being reminded of the vital need to speak up and speak out for others. In the wake of yet another brutal act of violence towards a Black person, demonstrations are raging across North America as people gather to speak up against these injustices. Kedron Bryant, a 12-year-old gospel singer, has used his voice in a powerful anthem for justice and the very basic human right to live.
I'm a young Black man doing all that I can to stand. Oh, but when I look around and I see what's being done to my kind, every day I'm being hunted as prey. My people don't want no trouble. We've had enough struggle. I just wanna live. God, protect me. I just wanna live. I just wanna live.
Powerful. And now Jessica has selected our opening hymn.
Hello, everyone. Before I sing Building Bridges, I just wanted to quickly say something about the protest and the march that was happening yesterday. I went to go see it, and it was very emotional, and the lady who was speaking, she was talking about bridges, and she was talking about how we need to educate ourselves and become one and work together as one. So please sing along. I'll sing it once. I'm pretty sure you know how it goes, but I'll sing it once and then just come in whenever. We'll do it three times. Building bridges between our divisions, I reach out to you. Will you reach out to me with all of our voices and all of our visions? Friends, we could make such sweet harmony. Very good. So I want to hear you snap. I want to hear you clap and really pay attention to the words, building bridges. Building bridges between our divisions, I reach out to you. Will you reach out to me with all of our voices and all of our visions? Friends, we could make sweet harmony. One more time. I want to hear you all. Ready? I'm building bridges between our divisions. I reach out to you. Will you reach out to me with all of our voices and all of our visions? Friends we could make such sweet harmony. Friends we could make such sweet harmony.
Sweet harmony. We take this special time now to reflect on our joys and sorrows. It's a sacred time in our service. It's a time that we set apart to honor the many sorrows and the many joys that you, the congregation, are living, and to acknowledge the mutual support of our community. Each week, I invite anyone with a joy or a sorrow to share at this time to relay their thoughts to me by email. This week, I heard from Pam Griffin Hody. She asked that we light a candle this morning for her cousin Tracy and his family, Jelana and Ashley. Their son Nicholas died suddenly this week at the age of 23 years. And again this morning and every Sunday until this plague passes, I light a candle for the members and the friends of our congregation who are shut in long-term care homes with no opportunity for visitors, and in some cases, without even the chance to get out into fresh air. John Patterson, Marie Davis, George Marenfeld, Irisha Cox, and Ann Wood are all in these circumstances. And now a candle for Allison Shipman, who's in Halifax Hospice on Franklin Street. She's getting regular visits from Sass Menard, from her brother and her sister-in-law. Allison has been reaching out to call others and comfort them. In particular, I know she's been in touch with Marie Davis. And for Peter and Mary Ellen Ono, who've completed a two-year plan to move from their home in Hatchet Lake to the north end of Halifax. They're both happy to be in town and in a great location. Later, when we stop the live streaming on YouTube and before the coffee hour begins, I'll invite anyone else to share a joy or a sorrow if they'd like to do so. And now Jessica will play the reflective hymn for us.
Can I see another woe and not be a sorrow too? Can I see another's grief and not seek for kind relief? Can I see a falling and not feel my sorrow shake? Can a father see his child weep nor be a sorrow filled? Can a mother sit and hear infant groaning?
May the joys and sorrows, both those acknowledged here this morning and those held in the silent sanctuary of our hearts, weave us together in the interdependent fabric of community. This morning, Marilyn Chenier will present a reading that speaks of the difference between lived experience and learned experience.
This is called Trungles, by a Vietnamese-American comic book artist and illustrator in Minnesota. Dear liberal allies, you and I learned very different things in very different ways. If you didn't live an experience, then step aside. We students of color, gay students, trans students, children of immigrants and refugees, knew this stuff before our professors told us what to call it. We learned it from the bottom up. You learned it another way. You received a key set of words and a list of definitions. Your learning was, in all likelihood, here is this word. This is what the word means. For you, it was xenophobia, a strong fear or dislike of people from other countries. For us, it was xenophobia. The time that boy in kindergarten class spat on me because I couldn't speak English yet. Or when I saw the clerk yell at my mom in the grocery store because her English wasn't clear enough. For you, it was racism, unfair treatment of people who belong to another race, violent behavior towards them. For us, it was racism, that one time I saw the manager tell the sales girl to follow my dad around at Walmart. Or that one time my neighbor's kid got shot by the police and they tried to cover it up by convincing everyone he was in a gang because he was Vietnamese, but we knew he wasn't. Or the time my dad told me I shouldn't rollerblade to the library because I'm not white and it's not safe for me. For you, it was homophobia, a strong dislike or fear of homosexual people. For us, it was homophobia, that time in the sixth grade when Ryan shoved me against a glass door and banged my face in it while yelling faggot at me until the teacher stopped him. Or when my Catholic high school's president told me that, though he loved me as a child of God, he still believed I was sinful. For you, it was classism, prejudice or discrimination based on social class. For us, it was classism, that time when my friend came over to hang out and her parents didn't want her to come again because they didn't like our neighborhood. Or that time when my friends had no idea what food stamps looked like and I was too embarrassed to explain what they were. So while you were learning that these academically framed phenomena were real problems, we were getting figurative name tags for awful things that we already knew. Your weekly vocabulary list was, to us, just a hollow shadow of our lived experiences. When you step out of class, you get to say, "Oh, awesome, I'm learning how to be a good ally and a better human being. This will help me." For us, it's more like, "Ah, so that's what they're calling it nowadays. When exactly did they say change was going to come for us?"
Thank you, Marilyn. Very powerful reading. And we're going to be dealing with some heavy subjects in the service today. But I'm going to start on a slightly lighter note, maybe ease into things. You can't have any doubt that we're living in extraordinary times. Take me today, for example. The most exciting thing that has happened to me in months is that I now have an appointment for a haircut. I don't have a haircut, mind you, just an appointment for one in a few days. And I'm really excited about it. I'm excited about a haircut in a time of pandemic, in a time of worldwide racial related protest. I scrapped my initial plans for today's service because the events of the past 2 weeks following the death of George Floyd in Minneapolis have shocked the world. That killing and the resultant protests come upon us in the midst of a worldwide pandemic and with as yet unknown consequences for the future. It's all been too much. It's been overload. Like many of you, I've been taken by surprise. When I first heard of the flu-like outbreak in China, I thought, oh, well, this will all be over in a matter of a few months. I had the confidence and the security of my privileged position to back up that assumption. I'd never felt that a pandemic might strike me down. Sure, that happens in third world countries, but not in Canada, and certainly not to me or my friends. And even the killing of George Floyd. For only one day, it felt just like another in a long history of injustices done to African Americans. I'm not proud of that initial response. But to be honest, I wasn't surprised. But then the world erupted. This was something different. My privileged position did not isolate me. The protests were in the streets of Halifax. I was called to take a stand, and I wasn't prepared to respond. Marilyn's reading just now puts it into context for me. I was aware of the epidemics in the world, and I was aware of the race-based injustice around law enforcement, but I didn't live into it. It was something I knew academically, not in my gut, not from personal lived experience. There's an expression that you don't hear much anymore when something surprising happens. My dad, I remember, used to say this a lot. He'd say something would happen, he'd say, well, what do you make of that? What do you make of that? Until preparing for this sermon, I never parsed that expression. What do you make of that? It's a challenge to deal positively with a difficult situation. What do you make of that? That's the right question for this moment in our history. What do we make of that? The world is no doubt changing around me. Maybe we're on the cusp of a new order. The thought is captured in a poem by Leslie D. White. She wrote, "What if 2020 isn't canceled? What if 2020 is the year we've been waiting for, a year so uncomfortable, so painful, so scary, so raw, that it finally forces us to grow. A year that screams so loud, finally awakening us from our ignorant slumber. A year that we finally accept the need for change, declare change, work for change, become the change. A year we finally band together instead of pushing each other further apart. What if 2020 isn't canceled, but rather it becomes the most important year of them all?" It's impossible to know at this point what the historical effect of the killing of George Floyd will be. But we know that the incidences of white police officers killing Indigenous or Black men is a symptom of a much deeper problem, of generational race-based inequity. In Canada, Indigenous people represent about 5% of the population, and they represent about 30% of those in prison or detention in this country. Similarly, Blacks represent about 3% of our population, but about 10% of those in prison or detention. These numbers point out an obvious problem, a very real human suffering. Suffering that we've apparently been content to live with for decades. It's not a popular sentiment at the moment, but you have to have some sympathy for our police officers. We as a society have failed to deal with issues of mental health and drug addiction and poverty and homelessness and the trauma of racism. And when one of these hugely underlying problems breaks through in our society, we call on the police to deal with it. Not to say that there aren't many wonderful examples of other social agencies and well-meaning people working very hard in these areas. But there's only one organization that we fund and equip and expect to be on the job 24/7. Only one organization that is left holding the bag when there's no one else to turn to. And that's our police force. The problems this creates are all around us. The same people who are expected to deal with violent criminals are expected to have the temperament and the skills to deal with issues of mental health, drug addiction, alcoholism, and so on. When you look at the statistics on the number of people in prison in Canada based on race, you have to accept the fact that our Canadian society is structured so as to create this problem. Our society is structured so as to perpetuate racial injustice. It doesn't happen by accident. We have a current example in Halifax at this very moment. It's the result of a confrontation between a young mother, Santina Rail, and the police in the middle of a Walmart store. Santina was wrestled to the ground and suffered a black eye and broken bones in a situation that would never have developed for you or for me. And that was in January. And the official response is that the matter is subject to the serious incident response team. And 4 months later, Santina is still told that she must appear in court now in July on charges of causing bodily harm to a police officer, resisting a police officer, and causing a disturbance. 4 months after the incident, 4 months after we all saw the videotape, 4 months after it was clear that she was approached, essentially charged with shoplifting when she hadn't even left the store yet. Our society tolerates a serious incident response team that would take 4 months to investigate and report. That's the way we do things. But we can no longer let obvious racial injustice simmer on the back burner while we take our privileged white time to conduct an investigation. Justice delayed is justice denied. I don't think anyone doubts that this case will not go to conviction. But we take our time going through the process, and people suffer in the meantime. But I digress. What does it mean to root out racism, to decenter whiteness, to end white supremacy? The task seems insurmountable. It's a generational problem. But I know of one relatively small organization that's struggling to show us how this difficult work might be done. I am tremendously proud to stand before you today, calling myself a Unitarian Universalist minister at this time in history. That pride's based on a lot of things, none of which are my doing. But particularly at this moment, it's in watching what the Unitarian Universalist Association and the Unitarian Universalist Ministers Association in the United States are doing. In unvarnished, unapologetic, in confrontational language, they've admitted that they have been and still are an organization of white privilege. They've overturned a long-established power structure. They're struggling mightily to share leadership across racial lines. And make no mistake, it's not easy work. The UUA and the UUMA are trying to find a way forward that does not privilege one race over another. The jury is still out on whether that's possible or not. But let there be no doubt about the efforts being made. At a time like this, when I'm confronted with my own complicity in an unjust society, I'm proud that I have a place like this, a Unitarian Universalist faith tradition, a UU faith movement, a movement that isn't frozen in fear or stuck in the past, a movement that believes in the power of prayer but knows that prayer is not enough, a sanctuary where I can listen to the hard truths, where I can be challenged to overturn my own prejudices, where I can admit my shortcomings, where I can be held and supported by people of goodwill who are struggling with me. I'm told that if you want an ally in this struggle, if you want to be an ally in this struggle, the first thing you must do is listen. And I'll close with some words from my colleagues in ministry who identify as Black. The first words are from Reverend Fulgence Nakajimana. Many of you know Fulgence. He barely escaped with his life from Burundi in Africa when he started a Unitarian Universalist church. He came to Canada and settled in Saskatoon, of all places. What I'm reading you is from his Facebook page posted on May the 30th. Fulgence wrote, "My dear friends and colleagues, it's been quite a few days. For people of color, and especially Black people, it's been generations and generations and centuries of abuse and mistreatment. The murder of George Floyd is horrible, and that's an understatement. But for Black people who live in countries where white supremacy reigns supreme, that murder is a trigger for what we have to go through on a daily basis in the form of arrogance, ignorance, belittlement, microaggressions, and ultimately death." Fulgence wrote, "I watched the video of the murder of George Floyd with my 12-year-old son. We couldn't finish the video. We had to turn away and we both cried. We were both angry, scared, and confused. My son then asked me, 'The next time it happens in Saskatoon, will you go to a protest?' I said, 'Yes, of course.' And then he asked, 'What if you get murdered?'" Imagine a 12-year-old having a conversation with his dad about the possibility of being murdered for being Black. "In the past year, I've had to contend with a neighbor calling the city for a car parked on the street because of, I'll never know why, a landlady saying that because of African food that makes her house dirty, she would keep our rent deposit, and people from my own faith movement refusing to believe that I'm a Unitarian minister as I attempted to enter a meeting venue all black. I came to Canada escaping persecution and murder and seeking refuge. And I'm grateful for the protection that Canada has given me and support of UUs. Even here, though, I need to breathe better. Many black people I talk to don't know what to do, and they suffer in isolation, fear, and anger because of the racism they're victims of. Tomorrow is Sunday. In circumstances like these, ministers wonder what to say. There's no beating around the bush. We all feel rage when our sense of justice is offended. There is no peace without justice. In anger and rage, go out and disrupt the white supremacy system. Here ends Fulgence's post. I have other words this morning from the Reverend Bill Singford, highly respected former president of the UUA and a person of color. Someone who has seen the UUA go through struggles, start initiatives, and fail, and start again over decades. Reverend Singford wrote, "I don't know what to write to you. I am a love preacher. I try to convince you and myself every week that love is real and that hope is justified, despite all the evidence to the contrary. We must face the truth, be present to it, visit the depression and the hopelessness. That's part of the truth I must know. That's part of the truth I invite you to know in yourself, that the truth is present in you. Or through me, or other people of color, if that's as close to the truth as you can approach. Let us individually and together face the truth, name it, so that we do not remain in either denial or despair, but can emerge more certain of where our hope lies and more willing to move towards it." So we ask you this morning, what do you make of that? It's my prayer this morning that we, you and me, this congregation working together, may turn an even stronger, more challenging, more powerful Unitarian Universalist faith movement right here and right now. A movement that helps us to give meaning to our lives, that engages with the world in difficult times. And I leave you with one thought. There is no denying the racial injustice in our city and in our society. And you belong to a faith tradition, a long established congregation with a proud history of fighting justice. So what are you going to make of that? Amen. The interlude selected and presented by Jessica speaks of the need for more to do more than preach. And I'm feeling that this morning. There's a need to do more than just talk. Jessica?
That was really good, Norm. That was really powerful. Before I play this piece called Preach by John Legend, I just want to say the three things that really have resonated with me. As a white privileged woman, the stories of racism is exactly that. They're stories to me. I don't understand. I will never understand. I'm not in their place, but I live with a black man, and my ex-boyfriend was also from Africa. And during these times, I could not believe that someone called him the N-word when we were walking down the street. And that really hurt. And that made me really angry. And I was talking to him and my roommate, and I said, what goes through your mind as a black man when you hear this? And he said, well, it happens. Like, it's bound to happen. It was just something normal for him. And he's been called a robber and anything under the sun that we just cannot imagine. I'm going to sing the song, and at the end, I'm just going to say a little comment. Every day I wake and everything is broken, turning off my phone just to get out of bed. Get home every evening and history's repeating, turning off my phone 'cause it's hurting my chest. And heaven knows I'm not helpless. Yeah. What can I do? I can't see the use in me crying if I'm not even trying to make the change I wanna see. I can't sit and hope, I can't just sit and pray that I can find the love when all I see is pain. Falling to my knees, and though I do believe, I can't just preach, baby, preach. Oh, all I hear is voices, everybody talking. Nothing real is happening, 'cause nothing is new. Now when all is tragic, and I just feel sedated, why do I feel numb? Is that all I can do? Oh, and heaven knows I'm not helpless, come on. But I'm only human. I can't see the use in me crying. I'm not even trying to make the change I wanna see. I can't sit and hold by, I can't just sit and pray that I can find a love when all I see is pain. Falling to my knees, and though I do believe, I can't just preach, baby, preach. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Oh, 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 yeah, I can't just preach, baby, preach. And heaven knows I'm not helpless. But what can I do? And I can't see the use in me crying if I'm not even trying to make the change I wanna see. I can't sit and hope, I can't just sit and pray that I can find a love when all I see is pain. I try to do the things that I believe in, yeah, but I can't just preach, baby, preach. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Oh, I can't just preach, baby, preach. Oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. I can't just preach, baby, preach. Thank you very much. Just wanted to say three things that really stood out to me at the protest and the march. They said, sorry, it's emotional. They said, we need to educate ourselves. The white people, we need to educate ourselves. We can say racism is bad, but do we really know the history of what it is in Nova Scotia? There was this one woman, she'd lived all over the world, all over the United States, and she said she had never felt blacker until she came to Halifax. There was slavery here. The black slaves built the citadel, and it hurts my heart, and I'm sure other people's hearts as well, to hear of Regis, Cora, Chinsky, Paquette, George Floyd, the incident with Christian Cooper in the park, and Eddie, at the protest, I cried. I just want to get through this. Eddie Carvery is a political protester from Africville, Nova Scotia, and this black community in Halifax, it was destroyed by Halifax, our city. We need to do something to not repeat this history. And Carvery started his protest on the site in 1970s, and he was the last one there. He didn't leave. And he started the march 2 days ago, and it was very, very powerful. And I want to thank you for being loving and kind, and we need to spread this around the world and educate ourselves further. Thank you.
Thank you, Jessica. Our offertory is a time of ritual, a time to celebrate the importance of generosity and leading a good life. And the congregation, this congregation, has responded again and again to this call. This message again from your board of directors. In this difficult time, our focus now is to pay staff salaries, to keep the food box stocked, to provide financial aid to people impacted by COVID-19 through the minister's discretionary fund, and to continue to provide a Saturday brunch in takeout form. If you'd like to assist with this, please email treasurer@uuch.ca for information on how you might set up automatic monthly withdrawal. A one-time e-transfer sent to treasurer@uuch no longer needs a security question, but please indicate what it's for, your pledge for brunch, for the minister's discretionary fund, etc. If you wish to send a check, you can use the church address. This message with gratitude from your treasurer. And now our closing hymn. In times like this, when we don't know what to do, may we turn to love as our guide. Jessica?
Okay, now it's time to be happy and celebrate. Love will guide us, peace astride us, hope inside us, will lead the way on the road from greed to giving. Love will guide us through the hard night. Come on, if you cannot sing like an angel, if you cannot speak before thousands, you can give from deep within you. Love, change the world with your love. Come on, I want to hear you clap. Ready? Love will guide us, peace has tried us, hope inside us, will lit the way. On the road from greed to giving, love will guide us through the hard night. Love will guide us through the hard night.
Our faith tradition tells us that you can't go wrong if you let love be your guide. As we come to the end of the service this morning, Tristan Saunier will read the words for extinguishing our chalice. Tristan, over to you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Tristan, and I'm going to be reading the chalice extinguishing words. After the words, a quiet. After the songs, a silence. After the crowd, only the memory recalls the gathering. Peace and justice have need of you. After the words, the music, and the gathering. May we continue the healing. Amen.
Thank you, Tristan. Once again, I extinguish the chalice here alone in our sanctuary, looking forward to the day when we can be together again in body as well as in spirit. Thank you to all those who attended the service today by Zoom or by YouTube. I'll say goodbye to those who joined us by YouTube as we end our live streaming. I hope that you will take an uplifting message from today's service into the week ahead.